New Jersey. Thank you for being with us this evening, and we hope you enjoyed the opening slide. Tonight's event is brought to you by Rise Up Newark, the New Jersey Performing Arts Center, and the City of Newark, New Jersey. Protest to Power is sponsored by the Terrell Fund, PSCNG, Rutgers University Newark, the Newark Public Library, the Rainbow Push Coalition, and the Center for Education and Juvenile Justice. And we also want to give a special shout out to our event partners who helped us to fill the Zoom room: the Abbott Leadership Institute, the Newark NAACP, the Newark Museum of Art, the Student Nonviolent Coordinating Committee Legacy Project, the Association for the Study of African American Life and History, the New Jersey Institute for Social Justice, the Newark 72 Collective, La Casa de Don Pedro, the Center for Economic Policy and Research, and the Amherst College Black Alumni Association and Class of 1965. As you can see, many organizations came together for this historic event, and it is my pleasure to introduce the man whose love for the Newark community gave us the platform to conduct this teach-in. President and CEO of NJPAC, John Schroeder, who will officially welcome us. And now, turning it over to you, John.
Thank you, Kalina, and thanks for that nice introduction. We're really proud at the Arts Center to be a partner with our city historian, Junius Williams, in bringing this program to life. We're also really proud to be a Newark-based anchor cultural institution and the most diverse performing arts center in the country in terms of our programming, our staff, and our audiences. What you're going to witness tonight could not be more timely and more essential, and all thanks go to Junius for being the inspiration behind it and for being such a good producer. I learned how great a producer Junius was when he chaired NC350, the year-long celebration of the 350th anniversary of Newark's founding. Over the course of 2016, he led the creation and production of over 200 events and activities all over the city, and over 100 organizations participated in the celebration, and they were all, like me, inspired, Junius, by your energy and your enthusiasm and your creativity. So we are lucky in Newark to have a once-in-a-generation leader in Mayor Ras J. Baraka. He is equal parts progressive, practical, compassionate, and indomitable in his leadership. And at this time of uncertainty and pain and possibility, none of us Newarkers could ask for a better boss. Mayor Baraka, the floor is yours. Thank you.
Thank you.
Oh, absolutely. Thank you. Thank you, John. Appreciate NJPAC's partnership always and the things that we're doing in the city. I just want to thank Kalina for hosting this as well, and all the work that you always do to make sure Newark is as progressive as it needs to be moving forward. And obviously our city historian, Junius Williams, for, you know, birthing this idea and bringing us all together to talk about something I think is incredibly timely right now, given everything that's going on in the country and the things that are being asked for. I think it's time for us to have serious kind of discussions about history, but history in the context of the present. And in how we move the city forward and move this country forward. The election of Ken Gibson, for a major American city along the eastern seaboard, was a major start in a pattern of things that began to happen all over the country. I grew up in the middle of all of that, and I can't wait to delve into this kind of discussion or whatever, listen to what people have to say about what's happening. Kenneth Gibson took the reins of the city of Newark in a very difficult period, difficult financially, as everybody was leaving and the tax base was eroding. As he was left to rebuild the city after a rebellion that is still being rebuilt to this day, and difficult because he had to unite a city with a bunch of folks who were at odds at one point, and he had to figure that out. And the expectations for him to do it by himself were enormous. And so I always look to him now, particularly when he was alive, to give me as much advice and discussion as possible. Just listen to his stories between him and my father's stories. I think I've got enough stories, and I have my mom's onto that too. I think I got enough stories to last a lifetime in terms of what was done and what should be done here in the city of Newark. So I want to thank you again, Junius, for allowing me and allowing folks to participate in this timely discussion about Ken Gibson, because it's not really just about Kenneth Gibson. It's about a movement that took place in a little old city called Newark, New Jersey, that sparked all kinds of things around the country. Newark is always small enough to have great impact and big enough to have an effect on the national scene. So whatever we do in Newark, and Kenneth Gibson was right, whatever we do in Newark will set the pace, will set the stage for many things to come nationally. So thank you.
Thank you, Mayor Baraka. Now, to set the tone and begin tonight's dialogue, I am proud to introduce our Newark historian, the man who brought us all together, founder of Rise Up Newark and the Abbott Leadership Institute, Junius Williams. Take it away, JWW.
Thank you, Kalina. Thank you, Mayor. Thank you, John. This is indeed a time for us to come together. You know, we had planned this celebration of the 50th anniversary of the election of Ken Gibson as the first Black mayor of Newark some time ago. And as a matter of fact, just about now, maybe a little bit later in the day, 50 years ago, exactly on this date, we had surrounded a bus that Jesse Jackson used to bring people in from Chicago. And there were about 1,000 people in the streets in front of Symphony Hall singing, "Didn't we blow your mind this time? Didn't we?" All along, and was to focus on the victory of the people 50 years ago in electing the first Black mayor. We wanted to talk about that ability to morph from independent street organizations to form a campaign coalition strong enough to take the city. Without help from the Democratic Party, the downtown corporation, just us, the people of Newark. But then came Minneapolis, Minnesota, of all places, Minneapolis. The murder of George Floyd and all that followed with demonstrations of outrage now in 2,000 cities across the country. And our examination of history became that much more pertinent, even urgent, because we too have been those young people in Minnesota and all over, and now all over the country and the world. And so we have lessons to share. You see, history is useful if it is used to explain the present and offer suggestions for the future. So just to begin this discussion, think of Newark as a medieval castle back in the 1960s, surrounded by a huge wall of racism and class privilege, where the rulers reaped the benefits of the fat of the land. Protected by a large army, the police. There were a few Black and brown people allowed on the inside as long as they played their role, stayed in their place, and their role was to come out and confuse the rest of us. But we who were the outcasts, the barbarians, if you will, over time we organized and busted a hole in that wall with protests, demonstrations, takeovers, and yes, the spontaneous rebellion that scared the hell out of the rulers of Newark. CORE organized demonstrations for jobs where the cops did nothing when white construction workers attacked the picket line. NCUP organized rent strikes and boycotted stores that cheated poor people. Welfare rights organization took over welfare offices when the welfare workers didn't give checks to poor mothers with dependent children. NAPA, my organization, took over the housing authority when they didn't house people evicted by urban renewal and highway construction, and CORE, along with everyone, fought police beatings and killings, John Smith, the cab driver whose beating was the trigger for the Newark Rebellion in 1967, set in motion a police onslaught that saw 26 people killed, all by the police forces. Louis Epperson, my friend, now go on to the great beyond, one of the organizers against the medical school taking 150 acres of land for the medical school, she said on public television, before the riot, nobody wanted to talk to me. Then with a twinkle in her eye, she said, after the riot, everybody wanted to talk. You see, we continued with our protests and confrontations and got quite good at it. Let me illustrate how good we were at the politics of confrontation. We took a busload of white ministers and Black Panthers, along with the Napa folks and the welfare rights regulars. We went down to the State Highway Department, closed the door, and unleashed the Panther that was in all of us. 2 weeks later, I got a call. Mr. Williams, we have decided we don't need that highway after all, so there is no Route 75 for you to be concerned about. But as rewarding as that and other victories were short term, protest over the long run is an unsustainable tactic. An unsustainable tactic. And so at some point, we realized we had to have an opportunity to come up with something new to gain staying power. And that's when we decided to take over city government, to change from the politics of confrontation to the politics of elections. As I said in my book, Unfinished Agenda, Urban Politics in the Era of Black Power, we had to choose power in the streets and power in the suites. So ladies and gentlemen of the jury, I suggest we are at a similar point right now. The question to young people, you have stormed the wall. So what's next? You will decide your own course, but looking at Newark's history might be very helpful. We have some people here who are gonna help us tell that story, how we change from one to the other. So let me just lay out an outline for what we're gonna use to tell that story. We can't tell it all, but we settled on four stories to tell. Number one, of course, police violence. Number two, the Parker Callahan fight, which was about who was gonna be in charge of the education of Newark's children. Number three, the medical school fight about rampant urban renewal. Some people had to move 2 and 3 times in a year. And number four, we wanna discuss the gateway to new politics, how we went from protests to power. And of course, we're gonna talk about rebellion, how that ultimately helped in the breach of the wall. We're gonna talk about the United Brothers and an event called the Black and Puerto Rican Convention, both imagined by Emiri Baraka, the father of our dear mayor, Ras Baraka. Both vehicles to ride the wave we created with our protests and uprisings to take over the bastion of power called City Hall. Along the way, you will see how we made the change, and in a race that saw a 73% turnout of registered voters, Ken Gibson became the first Black mayor of Newark. Now, two things I want to say before I finish my introduction. Number one, we've been getting all kinds of messages about Mayor Ken Gibson. We are not here to talk about Ken Gibson once he took office. We're going to discuss that part of the story later in the year, depending upon what COVID does. We'll maybe have a live conversation. But we want you to tune in to chapter 4 of RiseUpNewark.com, RiseUpNewark.com, which will be added to our existing website, which has already attracted over 1 million hits. It's been used as a part of the curriculum of Newark School District. Chapter 4 will be ready sometime at the end of July. Hopefully then we'll have that other event to talk about what Gibson did. Second, if any of you think this is going to be an argument between the olders and the youngers, you came to the wrong place. You can tune out now and still catch 90 Day Fiancé. There's nothing but love here and mutual respect. In fact, we're going to show you how to have an intergenerational conversation. Once we hear from the panel of Newark veterans, it will be my sincere pleasure to introduce, I'm talking about Reverend Jesse Jackson, the president and CEO of the Newark, of the Rainbow Push Coalition. As a matter of fact, Reverend Jackson, who's on the air now, has told us that he is going to have to be gone a little earlier than we anticipated. So I'm going to have that conversation with him now. But just let me say why he's important. Reverend Jackson operates out of Chicago and dozens of other places, but he came to Newark to help Ken Gibson get elected. And he certainly has a lot to say about the need to cultivate power in the streets as well as in the suites. Let me explain why. Jesse Jackson has been arrested I don't know how many times for the right to sit anywhere you wanted to on the bus, but also for the right to vote. And in 1984 and in 1988, he ran for president of the United States. In 1988, he got over 1,000 delegates at the Democratic Convention, came in second place to the man who ran for president that year. People don't remember that man, but they remember Jesse Jackson. He didn't win, but listen to what happened because of the power he had in the street that he was able to cultivate in that run for the sweep. With the fact that he brought in so many more new voters that influenced the election of certain other people. And I'm looking here at a book by Frederick Harris. And he talks about how David Dinkins' successful run for mayor of Newark, New York, had a lot to do with the new voters that Jesse brought in. And then you go down to Richmond, Virginia, and the first Black governor since Reconstruction was also elected because of the many voters that Jesse brought in. And then you take a look at what happened in 1986. The whole Senate was changed and flipped over to Democrats because of all those voters, especially in the South, who came in. And as a result, Judge Bork, B-O-R-K, was not appointed in the Senate, one of those right-wing senators, something we could certainly use today. So right now, I'm going to pause before we go any further and bring on Jesse Jackson, because he is the man. And I think Reverend Jackson is ready today. And I think I should start my video as well. Jesse, how are you?
I'm glad to see you. I remember back before you put that cotton in your head to disguise yourself. It's called Newark.
Tell us about the Newark, Jesse.
Newark. You know, the explosions in Chicago and Detroit, Newark, because police brutality. The same thing triggered the George explosion we've seen now taking place in our streets. I think a key to it, I remember one Saturday morning, Brother Mayor Baraka brought Ken Gibson out to Chicago. There were two Black mayors at that time, Mayor Hatcher from Gary, Indiana, Claude Soaks from Cleveland. And Baraka had to make some adjustments because he was the ultimate nationalist, someone building coalition. And then someone who had the spirit of the nationalist movement would reach out for it. Ken Gibson had the intellect, he had the courage, and had the credentials. You couldn't say no to Ken, he had the stuff behind. But the power behind him, in my judgment, was the Mayor Baraka. Because people are afraid of, what's the guy named, the politician, Diesel,
Mayor Anijo.
There was this fear of him. Blacks in Newark were afraid of him. And there was one voice consistent with Mayor Baraka's voice, challenging him in very public ways. And the night that Ken won, I'll never forget, we're downtown and people left High Street, left Central Ward and Newark Central.
Yes.
It came down there as if Newark really did belong to them for the first time. It was quite a glorious celebration. Ken was a hero because you had Hatcher, Stokes, and Ken Gibson, Newark. He set the pace for the country. It was a great crown victory for Mayor Baraka and the leadership he had done in raising Black consciousness.
So fast forwarding to today, we use street politics to elect Ken Gibson. You were part of that. We didn't have help from the Democratic Party. We didn't have help from anybody else with any money. And now you see young people doing the kind of demonstrations that we used to do and still do. But they have really rocked the boat. What kind of advice would you give them at this point?
And your arsenal of weapons is neither more powerful than the vote. The vote must be seen as a militant act, not as something passive. You know, in some sense, Jim Crow was worse than slavery. Slavery, these were our master protected us because of his own interests. We got the right to vote. That's when the lynching started. That's when they burned down Tulsa, burned down Rosewood. 5,000 Blacks were lynched. And the Indians were driven west on Trail of Tears. We were driven north, the Newark and Philadelphia on Trail of Blood. It was that season. But we somehow we knew that there was power in that vote. I submit to you today that Ken was Newark because he got the most votes. Don't run past the power of the vote. I had a session at the mayor now of Montgomery, Alabama, Richmond, Virginia, Selma, Alabama, Birmingham, Alabama, Houston, Dallas, because of the vote. We turn our anguish and our anger into power, turn pain to power. So I say that 4 million high school seniors should come around and say, with a diploma in one hand, a voter card in the other, march and protest, even go to jail, but in all not doing vote. Dr. King's inspiration, he said, was when Emmett Till was killed and he was assassinated, he was lynched. And they knew who killed Emmett Till. The jury was out 30 minutes, came in real quick, almost bragging about who killed him. And they stopped, they said, we've been cooking, we had to stop and smoke, we're getting a soft drink. And one New York Times ran asked a juror, why did you not convicted. He said, well, I cannot imagine a white man going to jail for killing a nigga. Dr. King said, if you had the right to vote, you could serve the jury. You could hang the jury and I'd be hung by the jury. So in some sense, jury duty. I said to a young man in Minnesota last week, Junius, I said, he was a registered voter. He said, I'm not in this system. I said, well, the guy who killed George Floyd, if he was in court, would you be, I wouldn't say I convicted him. I said, all those registered voters can serve on juries. That's a major land step toward our having political power today. And so, and so and the reason I would say march and protest, because that's a form of righteous indignation. It inspires people, informs people. But my God, we have the power to say, what happened before that time? We had to make bread without straw, the market without the vote. The vote would be to transform America. That's why you can have my campaign 84 and 88. You can have Ken Gibson become mayor of New York, Newark, because of the vote. But the street action made the vote inspire an inspiring weapon for us.
What kind of movement do you see that you most appreciate coming out of this particular situation that we're in now? Where do you see us going? What would victory look like as far as you're concerned?
Well, let me say, I have my fears. Many of your freedom allies are not your equality allies. Because the killing of George Floyd embarrassed white people, it humiliated us. It's not the image of themselves. And so we're humiliated and almost grown accustomed to these lynchings about bullets, about road. By the way, lynching is not yet a federal crime. listen to that federal crime. Rand Paul from Kentucky stopped me right now. I remember when we Peter Rodino was congressman and we supported Payne for Congress. They tried to run me out of the country, be a good guy. We felt the right to self-determination. Ken Gibson was the pioneer. Everybody that comes after Ken Gibson, a pathfinder. He created the climate. An engineer, had credentials, had reputation, could inspire people, not frightening people. And the role that Baraka played again was a big role. And then the minister got involved and that became a bigger deal. I was submitting to you today, my friends, and knew this is a great program we're having tonight to have a sense of our past and form our future. If those who are fighting today will return that pain to voting, we can just get this president out of office. More than we can have not just the president, 55 blacks in the Congress. If we count census, maybe 65. We have voter rights, which could be stolen unless we fight back. So I would say, and I guess last point is that police patrols, they don't control, they patrol. And since they patrol, they take power of themselves. Often they hurt people and they kill people and then we fight back. But the absence of police is not the present. You can have kind police with my health disparities, income disparities, lack of access to capital. So that if we just settle for getting a police reform without dealing with the issue of control, Mandela did not send you 27 years for a kind of gentler police of the school district. He did it in apartheid. And that's our challenge today, is not to sell for, that people who give us a police reform won't give us our share of contracts. There are 20,000 auto dealerships today, 300 African American. We dominate football, not one ownership. Baseball, not one ownership. Basketball, not one ownership. So beyond the patrol of police is the control of economic growth. Now, I think that your mayor today, Mayor Baraka, is one of the most seasoned young politicians in America today. I thank him and I congratulate him for his service. And his daddy is proud of him, Ben, and so am I.
Well, thank you.
And his mother, by the way, she's always so quiet, so calm, but she ruled the roost.
Well, thank you, Reverend Jesse. I appreciate you coming in, and I appreciate the work that you're still doing.
Love you, my brother.
Doing this for the whole time, but I'll see you further on down the road.
God bless you.
God bless you too. Thank you.
That was phenomenal. Such an honor to hear Reverend Jackson. He said, voting must be seen as a militant act. Thank you so much, Reverend Jesse Jackson, for gracing us with your wisdom today.
Let me continue with the introduction to our first panel. The idea is to have two groups of people discussing what Reverend Jackson has put out on the table for us. We didn't plan it that way, but I think it's going to work out fine. The first group of people are the people that I call the veterans, people who were here and played some role in what was happening with the movement and what was happening when we tried and successfully elected the first Black mayor of Newark. After we hear from that first panel about some of the issues that were involved in that whole process, we're going to hear from a panel of young people with varying degrees of experience in organizing and with definite opinions about power, how to get it, how to use it. I cannot tell you what they will say, but we're interested to see just what they think, how useful our stories will be. We can't tell everything about Newark. But we've decided we're going to do four topics. One, of course, is the police. Number two, we're going to talk about urban renewal. I'm refreshing your memory. Number three, we're going to talk about schools, and then we're going to talk about how we got what we got. My co-moderator tonight is Elise Boddie, professor of law at Rutgers Law School and a great advocate for justice. She will moderate the second panel of young people and introduce them at that time. It is my honor right now to introduce the three veterans. Fred Means is a former chairman of the Congress of Racial Equality, or CORE, of Negro Educators. Vicky Donaldson is a former director of homeless services for Newark Department of Health and a founding member of the Black Organization of Students at Rutgers. And Miguel Rodriguez, affectionately known as the Don of Puerto Rican politics in Newark, co-founder of La Casa de Don Pedro, Cura, Focus, and the Puerto Rican Congress. So it is with great pleasure that we start this conversation with Fred Means. Fred Means, you're the elder statesman here.
Okay.
Tell us about the relationship with the police and the Black community in Newark.
Okay. I guess it was in 1964, I was the president, I was the chairman of the Congress of Racial Equality. And I get a call one night from someone who said there's been a shooting in the North Ward of Newark. A young man named Lester Long was sitting in a police car for a long time talking to a policeman, found out later,
Martinez.
Martinez. And all of a sudden, the young man jumped out of the car and started running. And Martinez got out, aimed, shot him in the back of the head, like something we just witnessed yesterday, still going on. And from that, we developed a group to say, number of people called in CORE and expected us to get involved. And we did, because we had been involved all the time in trying to get a police review board for the city of Newark. And so later, I guess it was the summer of 65, we had a national president, a national president of CORE, chairman of CORE, James Farmer. We invited him to come into Newark, and we had a march from Lincoln Park down to Military Park. And there, several hundreds of people came about to protest this. Later on, Martinez wound up being a politician. Now, you see the connection. The police were involved back, starting from slavery time, and getting involved in keeping Black folks down, controlling. So here, you had a policeman who shot Martinez, and he later on became a congressman in the city of Newark. So there is that connection, and apparently that kind of thing is still going on today. So in some way, well, anyway, we were very much involved in that, and very happy to continue to protest and try to make. Now, we didn't get a police review board at that time, but we set the stage for it coming later. Today, our current mayor here has much better control with and work with the police than back then. So those were the early days, and the progress was made. It was started there.
What about the other two panelists, Vicky Donaldson and Miguel Rodriguez? What can you tell us about the police relations with the Black community at that time? And the response from organizations? Either one. Got to unmute, Vicky.
The situation with the police at that time, 1970, 69 and 70, was not unlike it is right now. They were seen as anti community in terms of how they proceeded and the policies that they implemented. When I say they proceeded, I mean, we were fair game. The context of the election in terms of community activism was that we were transitioning from the traditional civil rights movement and the period of Black Power or the Black Arts Movement was beginning to take hold. Black nationalism was beginning to take over street kinds of protests. Folk were tired of, you know, sort of turning the other cheek. The issues in the community were largely centered around the fact that Newark was largely segregated, even though our population was increasing. We couldn't work for the school system. We couldn't, for example, even when we passed the exams, we couldn't get jobs. The pivotal things were, in addition to the issues that gave rise to the rebellion in 1967, were concerned with the quality of education that was being provided, in addition to the discrimination. Parker versus Callahan, which is what you asked me to talk about, involved the fight by Wilbur Parker, who was a New Jersey's first certified public accountant, who had passed the exams to be appointed secretary to the board. Secretary to the board in Newark was part of a troika, we called it, with a superintendent in charge of education, a business administrator in charge of all the jobs, and the secretary to the board who was in charge of almost everything else. Wilbur had to sue. He eventually won the suit, and he was actually installed as secretary to the board after or around the time Ken Gibson's election had been completed. The second issue was that Dr. E. Alma Flagg was a premier educator. She had passed the national teacher's exam, was on the list to be appointed a principal, and could not get the appointment. She sued also successfully. These issues and the fact that Black nationalism, there were issues about the Black flag. The community was emboldened by the fact that the rebellion had resulted in no persons held responsible for the 54 people who died during the rebellion. These were all police related. At least we say so, as documented in Bob Braun's book, No Cause for Indictment. These things sort of were simmering. And by the time Ken Gibson was elected, we had taken over buildings at Rutgers. We had a largely organized student body of folk from all of the local colleges. We joined the med school fight, the fight for equality at Rutgers and admission to Rutgers. And we did the work. In addition to marching, taking over buildings, we had to go door to door. We had to canvass. We had to register people to vote. Then we had to get the folk out to vote. And we had to put that work in. We were not unlike the young people today. We took it to a step beyond the civil rights movement, and the next lag has to be undertaken by the young people today. They have tremendous numbers, which don't have a whole lot of meaning if they don't have strategy and if they don't put the work in. And we're just here to try and move the efforts forward.
So, Mike Rodriguez, talk to us about some of those same issues in the Puerto Rican community. People might say to me, I should be talking about Latinos, but there weren't that many Latinos other than Puerto Ricans in Newark at that time. We're talking about the late 1960s. So what were some of the issues that you all were concerned about and what were you doing?
Our problem really was lack of representation. We count only with four policemen in the police force in the city of Newark, that the director Espina always had discrimination with them. My community suffered a lot because for the discrimination in the city with the Puerto Rican, and the reason that we called Black and Puerto Rican because we was the majority of the Latinos in those days in the city of Newark. And at the same time, well, we recognize that we must got starting to working together and make coalitions with the Black community in the voter registration, because that was the only way that we can accomplish really what we try, that to get more respect, to treat us with dignity and job opportunities, because our contribution in the city of with the bodegas. And then when the we are most of our community was in the East Ward, and with the discrimination of the other group in the city, sometimes we don't come past from Lincoln Park and we got a fight. Then the police always chase us and say that was the Puerto Rican, that are really that we are troublemakers. And that's what we starting to get with our mentor, Dr. Ajit Hidalgo, Zain Matos, and others. And then we starting to register and starting to talk to the different group in the city. We went to the church, we went to bodegas, we went to the tavern, and we let people know that the only way that we can get some consideration in the city is that we have to participate in the political process.
Junius, may I also just add real quickly, the first time that there was a broad-based coalition and a whole system of alliances between the Black community and the Puerto Rican community sort of came together with the Black and Puerto Rican political convention. Hilda Hidalgo represented one segment of the Puerto Rican community, but you had a lot of militant folk who were sort of like us and our counterparts. The Young Lords, for example, Ramon Rivera, all these folk came together, and you had a mixture of old folk. I'm old now, so I can say old folk, and young folk who formed both coalitions and alliances. One of the things that young people today might take away from what we did or how we did it is that you have to form alliances with folk who can help you make strategies that will work. And you have to have coalitions between all kinds of cultural groups, because that's the only way that you can actually tackle the problems that confront them today. They've been killing us forever. The only way to stop folk from killing you in some cases is to make them think that, one, you're not afraid to die, but two, we're not about to die. And coalitions and alliances cushion the kinds of strategies and tactics that we might be able to help young people with today. All we can do is talk about it. I'm too old to march.
I agree with the sister, because really that's what happened. Ramon was in charge to organize the young generation, the new generation. I was in charge because Dr. Hidalgo provided us with assignment. Right. I had to go to different church to talk. I gotta go to the, like I mentioned before, to a civic club in the era, and we have to be diplomat with them because they don't understand. They say, why you gotta be together? Why we gotta be together? I said, the only way that we can get some representation and get some respect is we be together with the Black community, because we get the same agenda. We suffer from the same problems. And then Hilda say, if you wanna be in the city of Newark and you don't wanna be añangotado, you have to fight, and you got to register, and you got to vote. That's the only way that we accomplished what we accomplished in 1970. I'm proud to be part of that era.
So, Fred Means, let's get back to you. Tell us some of the memories you have. We talked about that. Well, here's some. So here's a photo of CORE in action. Do you remember where this was? I mean, what this was? It's in front of Symphony Hall. But do you remember some of those pictures?
Well, the one over on the left there is when we were down in Military Park. That was the CORE. That was the rally that we had where we were talking about police brutality. Mm-hmm. And Doug, I spoke at that meeting, and so did the president, the chairman, national chairman of CORE. That was a grand meeting. We pulled people together, and it was a very exciting time. And it took us, we didn't solve the problem then, but we started the problem, started the issues that would eventually lead to where we are today. Still struggling, but.
Now I noticed some of the people in the upper left-hand side, these were working people.
Yeah.
And it wasn't all students. You had a lot of people in motion during that time, and it looks like it was kind of ageless.
Yeah, that's true. We had young people and old people. People, suffering people, suffering people. I think the picture below that, is, I think that's Bob Kirvin.
Yeah, Bob Kirvin was the first chairman of CORE, and he unfortunately has gone on as well. So go ahead, Fred.
Yeah, and of course, Bob was involved in all of it. Well, you talked before about the discrimination in work and the corporations in the city. We were very much involved in that. Getting jobs for our people, because there was much discrimination. And matter of fact, that was the issue with the school system, the discrimination. In fact, I guess back in the 1960s, the Black student population was about 25%. And by 61, it had grown to about 55. It went from 25% in 50 to 55. In 60, and then it went up further than that. But the issue that about the Parker Callahan, let me just explain that we were talking about, and people were always saying, well, you got to be educated. You can't just have people who can't do the job. Parker, and as Vicky mentioned before, Parker had a CPA and Callahan had a high school diploma. But Mayor Adnesio said that he's going to appoint Callahan. And so we said, well, where are the qualifications? So we had a meeting, some of the teachers, we formed the Organization of Negro Educators. Some of the teachers met with the mayor. And we said, the mayor said, well, listen, you teachers, you need to know that education is about politics. He said, you know, if you want something, you do something for me and I'll do something for you. He said, for example, and he mentioned the name of a person, I won't mention it now, who said came to me and wanted something. And I said, well, you do something for me, and then I'll do something for you. And that man squirmed in his seat, because the rest of the teachers didn't know he was the one who had done that, that he had sold his soul to Adnesio. And so, but we were in many ways naive, but we were strong in that we wanted, and we were looking at quality. We were looking at success. And we were concerned about the quality of education in the city, not just the jobs. I'll talk about unions. I won't talk about unions tonight. But it's about the quality of the education that was important. And so the Organization of Negro Educators really was an organization to benefit teachers. But it was also a civil rights organization, because we were struggling. We were struggling for quality, for better education, and we were involved in everything that led up to Ken Gibson's election. As far as 66, the first time that he ran and lost to Adnesio, we were very much involved in that, from 66 all the way up to 70 when he finally won.
Well, let's change the subject a little bit. Not really the subject, but just the venue. And I'm going to talk a little bit about the urban renewal side. As I said in my introduction, sometimes people move two and three and maybe four times a year, because Newark was one of the most urban renewed cities in America. That means so-called slum clearance. But the thing was, they just cleared whatever they wanted to clear to take it for whatever they wanted to take it. And one of the projects they had was something called the College of Medicine and Dentistry of New Jersey. It then became the University of Medicine and Dentistry, and now it's the Rutgers University School of Medicine and Dentistry. They wanted 150 acres of land. And we said, no, you can't have 150 acres of land. As a matter of fact, we said, hell no, you can't have 150 acres of land. People say that this was one of the reasons why there was a rebellion in Newark. Maybe it was, maybe it wasn't. But before the rebellion, the strategy and tactics was all around protests down in the City Hall chambers. But after the rebellion, we woke up one day, my friend Phil Hutchings and I, Phil later on became the chairman of SNCC, the said, we have an opportunity here to do something different. So I was in law school. I went over and got some of the people from the planning school and architecture school up at Yale to design an alternate plan. We showed that they could do in 19 acres what they wanted to do in 150 acres. We also went and got some lawyers from the NAACP Legal Defense Fund, which was known for fighting segregation in the South. But here we said, here's what you need to be doing right here in the North. And they filed a complaint because they weren't enough housing to put people. So that drove them to the negotiating table. To make a long story short, we were able to get them down to 60 acres. We got 60 acres of housing, and all of that housing is still standing like Tosalt Village and some of the other New Hope Village apartments. Those are still standing, built by community groups. We integrated the workforce. We said for every journeyman, we have to have a journeyman. And if you want to have, if you want to say you can't find anybody, then you have to train them. And so we trained 600 Black and Puerto Rican people to take the jobs, and some of them got into the union. So my point that I'm making is that beyond protesting and taking over, we adapted and came up with some additional strategies, aided by that unnamed brother with the brick who was standing in the room with us. That's the kind of process that we were able to work out. This was the first major coalition preceding Gibson's election that brought us to a point where we said we needed to even further deepen that coalition and go into taking over the City Hall. Anybody want to comment on that? Do you have any memories of that, Vicky?
Well, you know, I was part of the coalitions, almost every one of them, with you on one front, with Gus and folk on the other, but Bob Curvin, of course, was my teacher and my mentor. And what he taught us was that, one, you really have to understand the nature of coalitions and alliances. You have to know how to organize. For this group of young people, you have thousands. We were lucky to get 50 or 100, we were in heaven. But the tools that we had were that we had to go door to door, walk it. Today, young people have all of the tools of social media and all the platforms from which they can launch the kinds of assaults on the system that we could have probably not even imagined back then. Coalitions are necessary because they cut across differences. Alliances are important because they are folk with like interests. For example, when people say, what can I do? My white friends say, what can I do now? I said, you need to form some alliances with folk who are like-minded and come together and try and change the mentality and the policy prerogatives that you own. For us, what we need to do is make sure that the coalitions that we act out every day are fruitful, that we put the work in, And we old people just have to listen, because every major movement in civil rights has been led by young people. And I'm gratified that folk like me can look with pride and say, we did have some impact, but our time is done. All we can do is tell you what we think, what we did. You guys have to develop a platform, a strategy, do the work, put it in, that takes us to the next lab.
While you're there, Vicky, we're going to show some pictures, because you were involved with another struggle. This was the struggle to desegregate Rutgers University. Rutgers at that time was one of the most segregated campuses. Of course, now what happened with BOSS, the Black Organization of Students, was the beginning of the change in Rutgers, which now is one of the most integrated campuses in America, if not the most. So tell us about the coalitions that were formed to make that operation successful.
We had coalitions and alliances. What we did before we took over the building was adopt a posture that we were not going back from Rutgers into the community. We were a sense of community into the university. Well, the famous takeover was not done without strategy and planning. For example, one that I hope the American can relate to, before we took over that building, we had meetings with every major civil rights leader in Newark in the room. Before we could say, come and support us after we take this action that we couldn't even tell most people about, let's go to the folk who have our back so that they know what we're doing and they can support us, and they did. United Brothers at 502 at the Heikalu, we met after a soul session, and the Black nationalist community supported us, the traditional civil rights community supported us. And when the opposition, the police force, and the white nationalists, to draw today's parallels, came together, they had a telephone pole, and they were going to break through the door at Rutgers. The Black Panther Party, the Welfare Rights Organization, to show you the diversity, the Welfare Rights Organization, NAPA, all these people stood in front of the doors and said, except through us. That's the nature of coalition and alliances that gets the job done. You can't go in and do something and say, y'all come with me after the fact. Bring as many folk along as you can. Do it with a lot of work, and folk will support you, because we're right. We have the right not to have to die just because we're Black. But I digress. I'm gonna shut up.
Well, we're kind of running. I appreciate that. You were very concise with that. And your point is well taken. And so we do come back to the whole question all the time about coalitions and alliances. Right now, I want everybody to take a look at this video clip of Amir Baraka talking about one of the greatest alliances and coalitions that we made across the city. And this is after we had decided we were going to start running somebody for mayor. This is when we decided we were going to take charge of City Hall. And so this is what Baraka's thinking was all about.
From looking to the government to solve our problem.
In a certain sense, it did represent it represented an attempt at self-help. You see, the Committee for Unified Newark was formed from the Spirit House, people in Spirit House who were mostly writers and actors and musicians, and the United Brothers, who were people who were interested in electoral politics from the Black side, and the Black Community Development and Defense, which were people who were basically cultural nationalists, interested in Africa, influenced by culture nationalism of Malana Karinga, and US Organization LA. I brought them all these groups together, and we formed the Committee for Unified Newark. And it was this group which was more or less a united front, although it had a cadre of cultural nationalists oriented Black people in it, My wife created the African Free School. We created one of the largest and best known cultural nationalist organizations in the United States. And it came out of that political will to transform this city. You see what I'm saying? And then that became a national kind of a thrust through the Black Power conferences, which by 1970 had become the Congress of African People. And by 1972, I was the chairman of the Congress of African People. And that was really the kind of thrust, the political thrust. But what exacerbated it then was the kind of white-black thing, the kind of like apartheid, where you had a whole army of white people running the city in City Hall. You know what I mean? And giving out little patronage jobs to select little Toms. And that's what we immediately set ourselves to overthrow.
One. One could listen to Emir Baraka talk for a long time because he had that rhythm. What came out of that was a process. And I think that's what we're really talking about here. We're talking about a process. It wasn't just protest, but it was a move towards power. And to do that, you have to have a process. And that process involved, as he said, Committee for Unified Newark started out as something else. It went into another phase. And of course, you care of the development of the people into voters. Now, once we got into that process, once we were into the Committee for Unified Newark and into the United Brothers, people started being attracted to what we were saying to the platform, and we had what was called the Black and Puerto Rican Convention. So we're going to show you another videotape here from Hilda Hidalgo. Miguel Rodriguez talked about her a little while ago. She was the lady who had very much respect in the Latino community and the Puerto Rican community, but also in the Black community. So listen to what she had to say about the committee, about the Black and Puerto Rican Convention.
From these conventions, we will make coalitions, so we will make partnership with anyone, polka dot or white, who believe in the things. But, you know, it has been said, okay, what about a poor white? The poor white is deserving of service. The poor white needs many of the things that Black and Puerto Ricans need. But the poor white has a passport card that Black and Puerto Ricans don't have. And as a matter of fact, unfortunately, you see many poor whites don't really believe that they are as abused as they are. So that is very difficult, but we hope to really educate and establish that kind of dialogue. You see, Puerto Rican unity and Black unity does not necessarily mean anti-white. It means that we realize that as a people, we have to get together and we have to do our thing.
So, Mike Rodriguez, would you like to comment on that comment?
She was our inspiration, and we was the cadres for her. She called us right away, and then we went to her house, and we sit down and in the basement of her house, and she provide us with a really a sermon. She said, "Now is your time. You gotta start into working together, and we have to make a commitment and agree to working together and starting our work." And Dr. Hidalgo was so bright, and she was really the one who opened the opportunities for Puerto Rican and Latino students in Rutgers University. I remember when Ramon Carrion, a bright young man who studied law, and he passed the test, and they don't let him, and they put him in the waiting list. Hilda called us, and then we went down there and we starting, you know, to make noise, and you know what type of a noise we used to make. And at the same time, Ramon Rivera, who was a part of the John Lord, Ramon came from Chicago. I was assigned to Newark, and I was in New York in the early days with the other group of the John Lord, and that was the we get together here in the city of Newark to work in, because Amiri was our friend and he know how much we suffered. And then Felipe Luciano came and to help us and help Ramon and help all the young generation here to be organized. But it was a great days, and I remembered how hard Dr. Hidalgo working and help us.
Okay, I want to thank the three of you.
Let me make one other point.
Okay, quickly.
At the time that CORE was trying to find a place to meet, it was a very forward-thinking pastor in Newark, Mount Zion Baptist Church, home of Tucker. And we couldn't have our meetings in so many other places in churches, but Homer Tucker said, yes, come have your meetings here. So a lot of the meeting strategies for the meetings were accomplished at Mount Zion Baptist Church in Newark. And many of the members of the church were involved in it too. It wasn't an official part of the church, but Homer Tucker said, come on in. And we were considered to be agitators by so many people. And the ministers in Newark really hadn't focused on the real story. They didn't realize that Jesus was an activist. And so that was very important, that we had a CORE, the radicals from CORE could come and meet and do our planning.
So that adds to what I'm about to say, because if it's anything I can take from what the three of you were telling us, everything that was done during that era was in the context of the politics of confrontation. You might hear that credit card that says, don't leave home without it. But at the same time, we were making plans to do other things. And one of those other things was process. You had to have a place for your meetings, and all, you didn't say this, but all the other big churches, even the little churches, were bought off by Mayor Anisio.
That's correct.
This was an unusual person. Dr. Hilda Hidalgo had to go to war, even though she was at Rutgers, she had to go to war to get this young man into graduate school.
That's correct.
And of course, we who were involved in trying to get something done through the United Brothers, not only did we have a place, but we had a process which was outlined very vividly by Miriam Baraka. So I want us to offer that as what we are trying to do here. We're talking about coalitions, we're talking about alliances, we're talking about process, and all of that has to do what is part of a successful movement. So right now, Kalina's gonna ask a question. I understand we have a question from someone.
Yes, we do have a question. The question is, what role did the issue of police brutality play in the election of Kenneth Gibson?
Anybody want to take that?
Yes, because they don't want us to participate. They saw the Black and the Puerto Rican together, and they starting to get afraid. And they tried to deny us to participate in the process. And that was, we starting to get upset and angry, and we starting to take care of business.
Yeah, see, Spina, the police, the police captain director at the time, worked, and Adnesio, who was the mayor at the time, they had established so many problems between the community, the Black community, and the police. And people were tired of it. And so when we started moving to change, we wanted to get Adnesio out of there. So we started to work to, that was an inspiration. The police brutality was an inspiration. The how you appoint people to jobs was an inspiration. And Black people, jobs were a problem during that time. And so people got involved because of their own needs and their own safety. And so that's why we were able to make Ken Gibson the first Black mayor of a city, was because we were in need. We had various kinds of problems. And we saw politics as being the way to resolve it. Because, and that's true today. We have a vote coming up in November. And but what we should do today is to change, because the politicians, the people who are in charge, make the decisions. And if we don't have persons in there who are consider our needs, then we lose. So I agree. Talking about voting, what we can pass on from the 60s to now, vote, absolutely, vote. And that's very true today.
We couldn't have meetings in City Hall without the presence of two obstacles. One, the white nationalists, and two, the hostile police. And sometimes they merged together. So there was always the danger that you weren't going to make it home the way you came, even in the official bodies. I remember one time, and I know Julie Saunders is on here, her father was one of the few Black policemen on the police force at that time. The police force was about 95% white, 5% Black. That fortunately, her father was on duty that night to save us from getting probably, maybe even killed. As I certainly beat up, don't have time to go into the details, but I will always be thankful for Carter Saunders. Let me say this, at this time, we're going to stop for a minute. We're going to have an interlude as we switch from one group of panelists to another. I want to thank you all. You've been very helpful. Stay tuned, stay put, because we're going to come back and have an intergenerational conversation in a minute. But right now, we're going to hear some music and give you a chance to see some photos. And some of you may recognize some of these people that you're going to see. So come on with it.
Thank you so much, Mr. Williams. We are so excited for the youth panel and the intergenerational panel. Please, y'all, keep on dialoguing in the chat box. Let us know where you're from, because we want to make sure we shout you out at the end. And if you have a question that you would like to ask, please share it in the question and answer part of the screen. Let us know some of the takeaways that you have learned from our dynamic panel of veteran elder leaders. Quote some of your power moments. We love to see them and share them back out. And thank you to the chat, because you guys are dropping a lot of information and sharing a lot of resources. Thank you so much. We hope you enjoy the short video, and we will cue up our youth panel.
Young, gifted, and Black. To be young, gifted, and Black. Young, gifted, and Black. To be young, gifted, and Black.
To be young, gifted, and Black, and own it. It's more than a moment. It's like the sun rose to condone it. Before we was trapping, we was trapped in. Sun and the whips kissing our Black skin. Strange fruit hanging, smell the jasmine. Ride the Coltrane, listen to jazz then. Back then, back then, back then. We came with names like James, Fatima, Nina, King, Dreamer, Redeemer of the people. Songs for the Hebrew, original, spiritual content. You can smell it when it's God sent. We keep it moving every day, we the target. The young, gifted, and Black on the market. Cause of that we pay with our lives, or either catching charges. But yo, the goddess isn't God's is. Young, gifted, and Black.
Young, gifted, and Black.
Goddamn, Ferguson, goddamn, Staten Island, goddamn, Baltimore, goddamn, America, damn. I tell you who I am, but you don't understand. Cross the waters I swam, son and daughters of the land. Yeah, we the black sheep, but you slaughtering the lamb. You try to silence with your sirens. Sounds of violence do nothing but divide us. Evolution of revolution, retribution is due us. The old ways of the U.S., it ain't the new us. Tell them we the stars, they can't shoot us. For prisons and wars, you can no longer recruit us. Salvation is due us, even before we came. God knew us. God knew us. Yeah, God know us.
So good evening. This has been just an amazing conversation. I'm so delighted now to shift to our youth panel. We have a really dynamic group of activists and thought leaders who are on the front lines for change. I'm going to start by introducing them in order, in alphabetical order. We first have Beatrice Adams, who is a doctoral candidate in African American and African diaspora history at Rutgers University, and Rise Up Newark Project. We also have Adorian Murray Thomas, who is the founder and CEO of She Wins, a leadership and social action organization for middle and high school girls. She also made history as the youngest woman to be elected to the school board. And last but certainly not least, we have Zellie Thomas, who is actively engaged in Black Lives Matter. He was part of the protests in Minneapolis and in Newark. He is a third grade math teacher and entrepreneur and a lifelong resident of Paterson, New Jersey. So welcome to you all. Thank you so much for being here. This has been an amazing evening. And one of the sort of the themes that I want us to reflect on is how we make sense of the past, right? What are the lessons of the past in this moment that we're in right now? And Zellie, I'd like to start with you. You heard Reverend Jesse Jackson say that we should see voting as a militant act. You've been somewhat critical of electoral politics as a means, as a tool for Black liberation and empowerment. And I just, as I was listening to Reverend Jackson, I kept wondering, what would you want to say to him if you could be in conversation with him about what he shared with us?
What he shared, I think, was like extremely powerful. And I don't want to discredit what he was saying, because I do think that voting can be a militant act. It can be a very important tool for us as a country, especially as a youth. But it can't be our only tool. It can't be even the main tool. And I believe that voting is essential in a democratic society. But the problem is America isn't one. America isn't one. And so many of our youth, I believe, and so many other people across this world, even though America presents itself as a democratic society, I think that deep in our heart and deep of our soul and from our own experiences, that we know that America is not a democratic society. So this generation has seen a cycle of Democratic and Republican presidents or elected officials being the leaders of this society, but not necessarily seeing any real transformative changes in our society. And nothing really talks to this experience more than the George Zimmerman trial. George Zimmerman was the white vigilante who killed Trayvon Martin in Florida in 2012. And there was a wave of protests all across the country because it was the beginning of the Black Lives Matter movement. And so many of our elders and so many of our civil rights organizations was telling us to wait, calm down, you know, hold in that anger and just let the system work. Let the wheels of justice turn because justice is blind. And I think that we all recognize on that day that justice was not blind and that justice was not colorblind, but it was definitely not leaning on the side of Black people in America. And I remember that day so much because we was in a room full of my friends and our hearts just dropped. And I know that all across America, so many other Black people probably had that same experience because this one moment we put our trust into the system and it failed us. So when I talk about voting, we don't want our voices to be heard every 2 or 4 years. We want our voices to be heard every day. And what these protests have shown is that what Martin Luther King said, a riot is the language of the unheard, that now Black people's voices are being heard all across the country, whether they're registered to vote or not.
So can you talk a little bit more, just practically speaking, about what that means, right? So I hear you saying that voting is important. It's not enough to transform the system. We also need protest. Mm. Certainly that's critical. But can you talk a little bit more about what's next? You've been on the front lines. You're agitating for change. You're bringing about change. You're forcing the issues. What do you think the plan should be going forward?
I think that the plan is a big shift from what we've been doing for the past maybe 20 or so years. That is this realization that representation is not liberation. And that what is really oppressing us is these systems of oppression. And sometimes that actually means it's these political systems. That we don't necessarily want like someone who looks like us, particularly in these offices, to oppress us. So it doesn't matter if it's a Black officer or a Black elected official, it doesn't matter what hand is beating us, we want the beating to stop. So what we are actually talking about is not just dismantling some of these systems and challenging them, but also experimenting on new ways of how to run society as well. And I think nothing is a better example than what occurred with COVID-19 and how so many different communities across the country seen how the government was failing us. And we as community members had to come together and share our resources and pool our resources in order to protect one another, support one another, and love each other. And I think that is a part of this revolution that we need.
Thank you. And so, Adorian, I see you nodding your head. You've been elected to the school board. You're arguably on the inside a little bit, right? How do you think you can change institutions from the inside? So as we think about how difficult it is to achieve change and you're on the inside of institutions, talk to us about what that means when you're on the inside and the possibilities for change.
Definitely. First of all, I don't think I'm the only one when I say that I am just so full from that conversation with whom Mr. Williams calls our veterans, just hearing from our elders who have been there before. And as they shared, laid the foundations for us to even be able to sit here today. It's honestly overwhelming. So I'm just truly humbled and honored to be here in this space with them and with each of you here on this panel. I think Zellie's absolutely right. Representation itself is not liberation. When we talk about Newark in particular, there's never been a point in Newark where the rich legacy of repression in this city hasn't been met with a rich legacy of resistance, right? So there's never been a point in which Black folks, Brown folks haven't been fighting and haven't been organizing both before and after they got to the ballot box. And so we understand that representation within electoral politics is key, but it's not the end. I think the question has to be twofold. both for those who are elected into these positions and those who did the electing, right? The voters, the citizens who got out there to vote, it's how and why, right? How did that person get there? What was their why in terms of why we chose to get them there? And to hold ourselves accountable to the how and the why, both before and after their service. You know, I think about when I ran last year at 23 years old, you know, it wasn't magic fairies that cast ballots for me. It was mothers and aunties and uncles and young brothers. It was a young brother in particular. I remember I met him, I was canvassing on Mapes, like we're off of Lyons Avenue. His brother couldn't have been more than 21 years old. And I'm canvassing, I'm talking to him, say, "Yeah, brother, you know, I'm running for school board. I would love to have your support." He said, "You know what, sis, I would, but I can't because I have a record. And because I'm a felon," and he used that word, he said, "because I'm a felon, I can't vote." And I think about, but here's the other thing that he said, "but I'm gonna tell my big sister though, to make sure she votes for you." And so I think about all the young brothers and sisters who wanna use that voice and can't, right? But now, because New Jersey passed the legislation to actually give folks with records the opportunity to vote again, you know, we are gonna move past that. But I think about how much hope and intention goes behind who you decide to cast a ballot for. Mm. And both those who vote and those who are voted for have to really understand the weight of that. You know, as someone who works with young people, I often wonder, and I ask them this too, and they get sick of me asking this question, like, do you really understand the weight of what it took for you to get here, right? Like, do you understand the protest and the organizing, the tears, the blood? And so I think that both those who are elected into office have to really understand that. And then it is the role of the responsibility, of the community to hold them responsible to that weight. So it's the role of the parents who do the voting. It's the role of the educators, the grassroots organizers, to say to the people who I voted for you for this, and that's not what's happening right now. So here's how I'm gonna hold you accountable. And how about this? If you don't do what I voted for you for, or at least engage in a conversation with me so I can understand what your plan is, then you're not gonna have that position again, right? And so it's the role of those who are elected. It's the role of those who do the electing. And then last but certainly not least, for the people who are elected into positions, and I say this to myself all the time, you have to be willing to lose. Mm-hmm. You gotta be willing to lose your position. There are so many people who get voted into positions who don't wanna leave. And so it's interesting, right? So we run on these campaigns of like, this is why I'm here. But then be so willing to, for lack of a better word, shuck and, yeah. Right? And one thing that the mayor always says, and you know, the mayor is someone who is just such an incredible leader, and it was so privileged to have him here on this this conversation earlier this evening. He said, "I ran for office, like I can't even count how many times I ran, and they didn't choose me. So I had to keep knocking on doors, and then eventually I built a way there myself." He said, "but I would never sacrifice what I'm here for the position itself." And so I think that sometimes we have folks who are so committed to the position and the power that it holds that they're not willing to lose anything, right? They're not willing to lose alliances. They're not willing to make people angry to stand for what it is they said that they stand for and what it is that they said that they got voted in to do. And so it comes down to that accountability.
Thank you so much for that. And Beatrice, if I could just shift to you. So you are a scholar at Rutgers. You also teach. What are your students saying to you in this moment?
I think one of the conversations I've been having a lot with my students is around their relationship to whiteness. How are they going to maybe model something that's different from the generations that came before them? And this is where I want to second the point that our conversation was so powerful tonight, because that boldness that you see in the what Mr. Williams calls the veterans, that willingness to imagine a world anew and fight to make it possible, I think that is what they're kind of starving to see, because some of the models that's been set before them, they don't want to embrace, right? We were having a conversation around Marxism, and they were asking, do I have to cite Marx or can I cite Cedric Robinson? Like, I want to cite all Black people. Like, I don't want to cite these old white men. And is that possible? So I think that one of the things they're trying to do is like negotiate this new relationship that isn't modeled on what necessarily they've been taught, but kind of having a radical imagination for a world that they want to see and they want to make possible. And I think also part of that is this conversation we're having around representation. I think they understand themselves to be the leaders of tomorrow, but they also understand that representation isn't enough. Like, if you have representatives, but you don't have systemic change, what does that really mean? So we've been having lots of conversations about that and other poignant historical moments. And in this moment, what I'm thinking most about, lots of people are thinking about the modern civil rights movement, but also think about Reconstruction, this moment where we as a whole country are coming together and thinking again and anew and afresh about the kind of morals we want to put at the center of our history, and also reevaluating what our history actually is.
So I think one of the things that we wanted to do was to move into an intergenerational conversation between the veteran activists and this panel. And so what I'd like to do is to call back our first set of panelists, Junius Williams, Vicky Donaldson, Fred Means, and Miguel Rodriguez, so we can have that conversation. And we'll wait for everybody to get queued up. Are we all on? Yes. So we're having this panel in recognition of the 50th anniversary of Ken Gibson's election as the first Black mayor of Newark. And since that time, we've seen progress, right? We've seen more Black elected officials. We've gained access to institutions that we were previously excluded from. And yet we're still dealing with systems that are oppressive. And so I guess the question that I want to ask is, how should we think about the significance of Mayor Gibson's election in this moment, right? What does that mean for us going forward? And Zellie, I'll ask you that question. Maybe you could get us started.
Sure. I think it was significant in the current context of how we are able to use the power of voting in order to mobilize a population in order to achieve a particular end. And this is why, again, why I don't discount voting as a useful tool in order to organize people around. I know that it was said earlier in the conversation about how canvassing was such an important tool in the past, where I still believe that canvassing is an important tool today, because there's nothing that beats, you know, these face-to-face conversations and building relationships with the people that you live with, and actually knowing where are their fears, where are their aspirations, where are their goals, where are their concerns about the community that they live in. And what we've seen was that so many people had the same goals, had the same aspirations, had the same thoughts, and instead of keeping them isolated, being able to organize these people in order to put someone in office that had the same goals and the same aspirations as them.
So Vicky, can I ask you to respond? You have to unmute.
Unmute.
Unmute. We can't hear you.
Okay, I my computer had failed, so I didn't get the first part of the question.
So the first part of the question, so we've been talking about the significance of Mayor Gibson's election, and yet we see that systems are so resistant to change. We've achieved progress, and yet we're still dealing with racial oppression. So how should we be thinking about the significance of Mayor Gibson's election in this moment?
I think probably because of the lessons we learned from the Mayor Gibson's tenure. We had never really had power or control. We had not run a city before. So we've got 50 years of practice. What this mayor, I think, is doing is taking all the pieces of both history and policy prerogatives and some sense of the future and saying, this is where we go from here. People like me are only useful in the sense that we can teach. For example, if you're going to go out, if you have 2,000 people and you want to talk to them about what kinds of things they can do, somebody has to train folk how to question folk, how to get the information you need to make a policy and put it together. Those are the things that I think 50 years now have taught us we know how to do. we know how, even I got my computer back up and running, so we can use the technology. We can use the lessons of history. We have some good folk out there. We have some energetic, intelligent, awe-inspiring young people. That is what you need to see, because all we can do now is help them find their way.
Elise, could I jump? I'm sorry.
Yeah, so I was gonna go to you next, Adorian, but I guess part of what I'm hearing is that, you know, this is an intergenerational struggle, mm-hmm. right? So maybe we shouldn't have expected that everything could have been achieved, right, 50 years ago, that we have previous generations who have now passed the baton. Yeah. So Adorian, what do you think, or say what you were going to say before I interrupted you?
No, I couldn't agree more. I remember the conversation that we had a few days ago with all of the panels, and when Ms. Donaldson shared that she was the first, the youngest woman ever appointed to the school board in the city of Newark, right? Because at that time, the school board was by appointment and not by elections. And me, born and raised in Newark, and you can't tell me I don't know anything about the history of the city, I had no idea, right? And so I think that the question becomes, one, are young people and elders who've been there, who've done the work both of today and the past, are we having enough conversations? Mm-hmm. I think that the answer is no. So conversations like this have to happen more often. You know, I think about the story that was told in the previous panel about Dr. Flagg, and we have a school named after her, right? And her story and her pictures, as soon as you come into the school, you see it. And so I think our young people in that school know the story and know the sacrifice and the leadership of Dr. Flagg, but that's something that all the young people in the city should know. And as a school board member, like, I need to do a better job of making sure that young people in our city know about the history of their city, right? And Mr. Williams is always on me, right, about making sure that we have curriculum that is aligned with our city, you know, and they've actually written curriculum, right? Like the Rise Up curriculum here in Newark that talks about what's the history of our city. So there's a lot of work that both we as young people need to do in terms of our conversations and then our action. The last thing I'll say too is that we have to like really reevaluate both what the tools are that we're going to use to get to liberation and then how we even define liberation itself. There was a time where to liberation for Black folks meant integration, right? And for Black folks and Brown folks meant electing a Black mayor and having Black folks in electoral positions and desegregating Rutgers and Bloomfield College. But the answers are more tricky now, right? Because it's not that black and white. Because we have folks who look like us in office. We have schools that are technically integrated, right? But we're still fighting some of the same battles. So I think we have to ask ourselves, one, how do we define the destination that we're fighting for and have currently, or do they suffice, right? You know, Audre Lorde said that you can't use the master's tools to dismantle the master's house. Right. And so we have to ask the question of do the tools that we have today, are they sufficient? And if not, what do we have to couple them with, modify them with, or strictly like abolish and replace with so that we can actually be effective once we define what that path towards liberation actually looks like for us today?
So Beatrice, can I ask you to reflect on what Adorian said and give us some historical context for the struggle for Black liberation and empowerment? And what do you think about the lessons that we should be drawing from the past?
First, I want to say I feel like that's a call to action for me and my folks. So many of us are concerned about the academic job market, but I feel like in this moment, Black and Brown researchers need to be thinking about public-facing work, work that isn't just made for our communities, but made for the communities, our larger communities. So not just talking to each other, which we're very good at doing, but talking to those, like those on the Zoom, those on the panel, sharing our work with others. So I think that we should be thinking about public facing work, but to answer the question, sorry, I had a brain fart.
So just what are the lessons of history?
Thank you for the question again. I think the lessons of the history are perfect because the job wasn't complete but it also wasn't possible unless that was done already. Like, we can't be thinking beyond civilian police boards if we hadn't already had civilian police boards and seen the limitations of that as a strategy for liberation. We can't be thinking beyond without the generations that came in front of us. So I think it's important to kind of return to the history and look at the strategies that have already been used and kind of say, is this working for us still? Or is this a new strategy that we need to reinvent? And I think a lot of that is already happening when people are talking about defunding the police, right? They're already speaking to kind of some of the strategies that have been used in the past and thinking beyond and creatively about a new and better tomorrow that maybe doesn't look like something we've seen before, but definitely is rethinking critically about where we've been already.
So Fred, I see you leaning forward. So actually I'll ask you to respond, and then also, what do you think about defunding the police? That is one of the questions that I believe was in the chat.
Well, let me just say something about accountability. One of the things that I noticed with the transition from being on one side of the microphone to being on the other side of the microphone, it's a different position. And if in fact you get on the other side of the microphone where you're listening now, and you're having you're making decisions now, you have to be accountable. I watched too many people who were out in the street with me fighting and protesting, but when they got on the other side, they didn't carry out, they weren't accountable for the kinds of things that we had been fighting for. So that's a danger that you have to be aware of that. And people that voted in, if they are not accountable, you vote them out. But that's something you're gonna have to be careful about. Is people, you're on one side of the microphone and you're fighting, you get on the inside of it and you start doing some of the same stuff. And you see, that's a problem. Now, what was the other part of what you asked me?
I was asking about defunding the police, but I also see that Vicky had her hand up, so.
I just have a quick question. Yeah. What Adorian, Beatrice, both suggest, and Fred, is that we need to consider whether or not we want the master's house. Mm-hmm. Maybe the things that built the master's house aren't made for us. And maybe we need to rethink what it is we want. Defund the police, rename the police, change the priorities. Maybe we need to build our own house and look at ways to build it differently. Because you cannot change quickly a mentality that says you're not even a person. From the civil rights movement, it was, I am a man. Remember a major slogan? And today it's Black Lives Matter. But they both suggest the same kind of notions. The master's house was built for master.
Miguel, I see your hand up, and then we'll pivot back to Junius to close us out.
Yes, I believe that we, the young generation and and the senior citizen, we must have to continue to talking and to get forums and to exchange and to get better communication. The problem right now is everybody is separate because the media are keeping us most of the time separate now. In the old days, we used to sit down and go different houses and get coffee crush and discuss. And Saturdays, we used to go to Ken Gibson Civic Association, and we used to sit down and discuss with Clarence Kagan, one of my mentors. And we sit down the next day with Gus Henningborg. All those are person with experience and person that we have to exchange and we have to get together. I agree that he said that voter registration is not the only solution and it's not the only. The other part is economic, okay? We have to create our own business, and economic development is part of the key of the society.
Thank you for that. So Junius, I'm going to turn it back to you to close us out.
I was enjoying listening. We have some very smart people And this is how we talk to each other. Clearly, the young people that we have here reflect the folks that are in the street. They've thought about these issues. It's just not folks mad any more than we were just mad. I think people get the wrong impression of what it means to be in bondage. It doesn't mean that you're not thinking. And we who believe in freedom cannot rest until it comes, but that means we have to be thinking about it all the time. So I'm sorry Jesse couldn't be here with us and add a few more words, but at this point, I just want to ask that we bring back Kalina Berryman. I want to thank everybody who's been participating at this time. We're going to try to end close to 9 o'clock. We still got over 500 people who've been glued to their television sets, to use the parlance of the 1960s from which I cometh. But what we're going to try to do now is just to say thank you. I want to bring back some of those slides that we have for some of our partners, some of to let you see who we were, people, in case you weren't here at the beginning. Kalina, what do you have to say for us?
Yes, as we bring back our partner and sponsor slides, we want to say thank you to the over 1,000 people who joined us on Zoom and Facebook. This conversation absolutely needs to be shared. We are recording and will share the recording, but you can share it right now. It's on the NJPAC Facebook page. So if you want to get this conversation out to the masses, go to NJPAC's Facebook page and share it. And I just want to take a minute, Mr. Williams, to shout out some of the places where folks joined us from: Virginia, California, Georgia, the United Kingdom, Hawaii, Alabama, Minnesota, South Carolina, and Florida, just to name a few. So thank you all so much for being with us. And just to recognize our sponsors again, the Terrell Fund, Rutgers University Newark, PSCNG, the Newark Public Library, the Rainbow Push Coalition, and the Center for Educational Justice, Education and Juvenile Justice, and to our dynamic group of partners, the Abbott Leadership Institute, the Newark NAACP, the Newark Museum of Art, the Student Nonviolent Coordinating Committee Legacy Project, the Association for the Study of African American Life and History, the executive director was with us this evening, the New Jersey Institute for Social Justice, the Newark 72 Collective, La Casa de Don Pedro, the Center for Economic Policy and Research, and the Amherst College Black Alumni Association and Class of 1965. And of course, to those who brought us this event, Rise Up Newark, you can learn what we learned here and much more at www.riseupnewark.com, NJPAC, and the City of Newark. Thank you all so much.
And so what we also want you to do is to wait for chapter 4. If you didn't get all of what we had to say today, and you want to go further into what happened with Mayor Ken Gibson, wait till you see chapter 4. That's going to be a real winner. I told you before, more than 1 million people have hit us up, and I think 1 million more will probably come forward when they see this next chapter. We also want you to be aware of some of the other things that are going on with programs like this. We have, let me see, some of the things that we want everybody to get registered to vote. Since we have so many people calling in from England and from California and Hawaii, I know who that is in Hawaii, but I didn't know about all of these other people tuning in. And we do have over 1,000. But I want to just shout out a couple of people here. If you gotta go, you gotta go. But I just wanted to know, let folks know some of the people who were here with us today. Tom Moran, who was editor on the Star Ledger and NJ.com. We got Dr. Joy Leary, author of the book Post-Traumatic Slave Syndrome, an excellent read. We got Rick Thigpen from Public Service Electric and Gas, who was one of our sponsors. You saw his father, Phil Thigpen, in one of the pictures. You may not have recognized him, because he goes back to the election of the first Black councilman, Irvin Turner. Reba Foster, chairman of the Black Issues Convention. And one of my favorite folks, Congresswoman Bonnie Watson Coleman, Bill Payne, former assemblyman, Deborah Smith Gregory, NAACP, Tom Alruz, the director of the Newark Public Library. So Sylvia Cyrus, I thought I said that, from Osala.
Yes.
Eileen Applebaum from the SEPA.
So, yes, Mr. Williams, we also had Reverend Luis Roundtree, leader of clergy of the city of Newark, Reverend William Howard, and former superintendent of Newark Public Schools, Mr. Eugene Campbell, were with us as well.
Now, we may have missed them, just as we used to say in my church, consider that love. We still love you. We didn't need to omit you. I want to hear that music now, because that's going to tell you just how we feel. So until next time, we're going to be doing some more things, y'all. We want to, I got it. Where's that other chart for the people who work with us? Where's the team chart, Galena?
Yes, yes.
Let's see that team chart. How can I stop without talking about the team? Couldn't do this by myself. Of course, Kalina Berryman. We have ridden the range together for a long time. And we're back together again.
That's yes.
Right. Chelsea Keys from NJPAC. Chelsea, thank you. Thank you. We've got Che Williams from Che Williams Production. I wonder where he came from. Peter Blackmer, researcher and media. Che did the music production and selected some of the songs. You've got Deanna Marie Crespo Norcross from Mosaic Strategies Group. And of course, Francesca Larson, who was the director. Come on up, Francesca, so people can see you. Now, if you go to riseupnorth.com, you'll see how beautifully that is done. Francesca did the planning and the building of that website, but she is also the director here. She's the one in back who was making sure that everything ran so smoothly. I don't see you coming up, Francesca. I guess you don't want to be up. But
I'm here, but you
there she is. Francesca from Mosaic.
You want some music played, so I still have work to do.
I want to see you, and I want to hear the music at the same time. I want it all. I want everything. What's wrong with that? I'm an old man. I deserve it. So here's the music that we want to leave you with. Come on back with us the next time when we do something good. Thank you all for coming in.
And Mr. Williams, did we recognize Chelsea Keys from NJPAC? I wasn't sure. She is awesome.
I did indeed.
Okay, good. Thank you.
John Schreiber, you know I love you. We couldn't have done it without you. This was NJPAC's platform. When we had 1,000 folks registered, they increased it. So thank you, John. Thank you, all the people who were involved with us. Thank you, Mayor. Thank you, Mayor. We have a good mayor, a great mayor. A lot of things we could say about this mayor, how he helped the homeless people get tested and put them up in a hotel so that they could get some kind of relief from COVID. Vicky said, maybe it took us 50 years to get to a point where we've got a good mayor who understands what has to be done in the context. People, we love you. We want you to keep on doing what you're doing out there in the streets, but also consider joining the suite, because we need your minds in both places at the same time.
That's right.
Where's that music?
Power to the people.
Well, I'll keep talking if you don't play that song.
Power to the people.
It's coming. Will you start it by singing it for us?
If you give me the key, I will sing it. But I'm not going to do that. I would rather hear them sing it.
All right, I hear it coming in.
Here it coming in.
Ain't no river wide enough, baby.
If you need me, call me. No matter where you are, no matter how far.
Don't worry, baby.
Just call my name. I'll be there in a hurry. You don't have to worry.
Oh, baby, there ain't no mountain high enough. Ain't no mountain low enough. Ain't no river wide enough to keep me from getting to you, baby. Remember the day I set you free? I told you you could always count on me, darling. From that day on, I made a vow. I'll be there when you want me, somewhere, somehow. Oh, baby, don't.